At magandang hapon po sa lahat ng nakikinig sa atin dito lamang sa ating nag-iisang Radyo Migrante sa Vibe 105, your main source. Maaari nyo rin kami pakinggan sa www.vibe105to.com, sa Bell 5973, Rogers Digital Cable 945, or sa tunein.com sa inyong mga web browsers at smartphones. Ang inyong pong mga makakasama ngayong hapong ito ay ang inyong mga tagapaglingkod na si Rhea Gamana, Jack Cristobigon, and Ish Cabanya. Hello!
Hello there!
Kumusta?
Yeah, we're good. How are you?
Hello, kamusta? Yeah, hello. Ayon. Thank you for our listeners who I know for sure you guys are listening from all the way in Hamilton, in Montreal, in other places, in Toronto, in all various places in Canada. Hello. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. So magandang hapon, maayong hapon sa tanang gapaminaw din na.
Maayong hapon sa tanan.
Exactly. Maayong hapon.
Ayon. Okay. So ngayon sa ating... before actually, no, People Power Uprising, no, commemoration sa atin,
yes,
sa Pilipinas.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So it's the 32nd People Power.
Really?
Mm-hmm. So much to talk about, but not today.
Yeah.
Maraming...
So much to talk about age?
Ikaw na sabi na hindi ako.
Well, I haven't been born. I wasn't born then.
But we know what happened during that time.
Change topic, eh, no? But...
Oh my gosh. Okay. So, tuloy-tuloy po tayo sa ating Radyo Migrante, and I'd just like to let everyone know na ang Radyo Migrante po ay proud member of Altermedia, People's Alternative Media Network, kaya mabuhay ang Altermedia. Okay.
Yeah.
So, ano nga ba pag-usapan natin ngayong hapong ito?
Ano nga ba? Jack,
our topic for today is going to be on the 5-year pilot project on caregiver program.
Yeah.
At kung paano ito nakaka-impact sa mga buhay-buhay ng mga caregivers natin dito sa Canada.
Yeah, yesterday there was a caregiver gathering, no?
Yeah.
In Spadina here in Toronto. So there were consultations as well, how we can move forward. So we'll talk about that with Anna Mala of Caregivers Action Center.
And here are the latest Radio Migrante news. OFW found in freezer in Kuwait is back home. Lebanese male employer of the Mafelis nabbed while the wife is still at large. The Department of Foreign Affairs, or the DFA, announced on Friday night that one of the principal suspects in the slaying of overseas Filipino worker Joanna de Mafelis in Kuwait is now in the custody of authorities in Lebanon. The Philippine Embassy in Kuwait reported the arrest of Asaf to Manila the same day the chief executive visited the wake of de Mafelis and assured her family that the government will seek justice for her and other OFWs abused by their employers abroad. The arrest of Asaf came several days after Cayetano was assured by Kuwaiti Ambassador Musaid Al-Tuwaik that Kuwaiti authorities will do everything they can to find the suspects and bring them to justice. Some 103 OFWs have died in Kuwait in 2017 and 82 in 2016. Approximately 5,800 Filipinos leave the Philippines every day to work abroad as overseas Filipino workers or OFWs.
And for our next news, Pinoy's mark 32nd anniversary of EDSA People Power Uprising. Hundreds gathered on Sunday morning in various public places in the Philippines and abroad to commemorate the 32nd anniversary of the People Power Uprising. Filipinos from all walks of life commemorated the protest actions and acts of resistance that toppled in 1986 the two-decade Ferdinand Marcos dictatorial rule. In EDSA, the historic Salubungan between the members of the military and the police and civilians is reenacted at the People Power Monument. The 1986 People Power Revolution was not an end, but instead is a fresh start for Filipinos, according to the former president Fidel V. Ramos. Meanwhile, people from different groups and sectors, including students, protested the cha-cha moves or constitutional change and other human rights violations by the current administration in rallies. In Davao, from where the Philippine president hails, human rights groups reminded that the struggle against the Marcos dictatorship was key to President Rodrigo Duterte's rise to power.
And Trudeau government creates roadblocks for caregivers. The Trudeau government has recently canceled a path to permanent residency for many caregivers without any consultation with workers participating in Canada's caregiver program. A new announcement posted on the Immigration, Refugee and Citizenship Canada website states, quote, "These five-year pilot programs, caring for children and caring for people in high medical needs, are scheduled to expire in November 29 of 2019. To be eligible to apply for them, you will need to have 2 years of full-time work experience as a caregiver and submit your application before that date," end quote. The changes are particularly concerning for caregivers in abusive workplaces who will now face additional pressures to remain with current employers. Another major challenge under Canada's current system is that some caregivers arrive in Canada but are not provided with the work they were guaranteed.
At yun po ang ating nagbabagang news and headlines ngayong hapong ito. Sa ating puso na migrante po ngayong hapong ito ay pakikinggan po natin yung mga caregivers po na nakausap natin kahapon mula doon sa caregivers unity gathering na ginanap sa Migrant Workers Alliance for Change Office, no, kahapon, kasama po yung iba't ibang organisasyon at mga individual na concerned, no, doon sa mga pagbabagong magaganap sa caregiver program that's actually a 5-year pilot program. So pakinggan natin ang kanilang mga opinion at ano sa tingin nila, paano sila apektado, no, doon sa issue ng 5-year caregiver program.
Yung pagbabago pong ito ay nakakatakot sa part ko. I am worried kasi unang-una undergraduate ako. Ngayon, nung nalaman ko yung update ng immigration or yung CIC, I am pressed on time kasi unang-una kailangan kong buuin yung post-secondary education. So, hindi ko alam kung ano ang gagawin. Dahil kung mag-aaral ako at kumpletuhin yung units ko, mahal. Eh, kailangan ko pang magpadala ng pera sa Pilipinas at ganyan. Makokompleto ko naman yung 24 months until November 2019. However, andun yung takot na mapapauwi ako sa Canada, lalo na't hindi ko makokompleto yung eligibility requirements. So, nandito ako ngayon dahil gusto kong kailangan ko ng guidance, ng assistance, ng suporta. Kaya napakalaking pasasalamat ko at meron nabuo yung ganitong meeting.
Pilot program ay talagang apektado ako doon kasi under ako doon, which under new pathway or under rule. Kasi nung pagpunta ko dito ay hindi ako na-inform kung ano ang requirements for applying for PR, which nung andito na ako at ngayon nga malapit na akong mag 2 years, malapit na sanang mag-apply, nalaman ko na kailangan namin ng education credential assessments, which is dapat magkaroon kami ng 1 year certificate equivalent Canadian education. So apektado ako doon kasi undergraduate lang ako sa Pilipinas, so hindi ako magkakakuha ng 1 year certificate equivalent to Canadian education. Ngayon, ang paraan daw noon ay mag-aaral ako ng, kukuha ako ng 1 year certificate dito sa Canada, which kung mag-aaral na ako ngayon, kukuha ako ngayon, eh napakahirap kasi start from now, hindi mo naman, hindi ka naman makapag-aral ng full-time as a student, kundi part-time lang yung student. So, hindi mo matatapos ng one year, yung one year certificate na yun. So, maaabutan pa rin ako yung pag-close ng pilot program. So, talagang apektadong-apektado kami sa pabago-bagong program ng Canada.
Bilang isang apektado dito sa live-in caregiver, para sa akin, napakalungkot ng reaction ko nung una ko lang na malaman to. Kasi unang-una, we know Canada. Ang Canada, napakagandang bansa. Alam natin may maganda tayong future dito, lalo kung may family tayo. Kasi alam natin kaya tayo umalis ng bansa is para magkaroon tayo ng mas magandang buhay. Oo, sabihin natin, meron tayong opportunity o trabaho sa Pilipinas. Tulad ko, nurse ako sa Pinas. But I choose na maging live-in caregiver dito kasi alam ko na meron dito akong future na pwede kong mabigyan na mas magandang buhay ang magiging pamilya ko. And now, I'm on this program na alam ko apektado ako. Pag nakat or natuloy itong law na pinopropose nila o sinasabi nila ng gobyerno, ano, questionable sa akin, anong mangyayari sa akin after? Ano, babalik ba ako ng Pinas? Magiging maaabot ko ba yung gusto kong maabot para sa pamilya ko? Parang I'm fear of unknown because I don't know what will happen next. Yun lang, parang sa iba kasi umalis tayo para magkaroon tayo ng magandang kinabukasan para sa pamilya natin, para sa sarili natin, para sa pangarap natin. Pero ngayon na nandito tayo, tapos maririnig natin na yung pinapangarap natin, yung expected natin na mangyayari is parang ngayon hindi na pwedeng mangyari. Kahit sino ang nandito sa lugar na to or nandito sa position na to, napaka down or napakalungkot at isipin natin nakakatakot kasi wala tayo sa bansa wala tayo sa bansa na sarili natin, hindi natin alam kung ano mangyayari. At sabi nga nila, pinaka nakakatakot sa buong mundo is unknown. You don't know. Hindi mo alam kung ano mangyayari bukas. Hindi mo alam kung anong mangyayari sa paligid mo.
Akong nani dito sa Canada under new pathway so in-home caregiver. So hindi kami na-inform from the start na nag-apply pa lang kami na application na kailangan yung mga caregiver na papasok dito is college graduate or bachelor. Hindi namin alam, which is ang problema namin dito is undergraduate kami, hanggang second year college lang kami. So, naka-isang taon na ako dito. Ngayon, nakahang kami kung makaka-apply kami ng PR after 2 years. Tapos nalaman din namin ngayon sa meeting ng migrante na ang iba yung pagkakaalam namin. Dahil ang alam namin, after namin makatapos ng 24 months sa caregiver, pwede kami mag-aral. At pag nakapag-aral kami, pwede na kami mag-apply ng permanent residence, pero hindi pala. And yung reason kung bakit kami nandito is para sa family. So parang yung diba yung sabi nga na we have to do some sacrifices for the better future. Paano ko makikita yung better future kung hindi ako mabibigyan ng permanent residence at hindi ko madadala yung family ko dito? Yun lang. Thank you.
At yun po ang ating pulso na migrante ngayong hapong ito. Maraming salamat po sa mga caregivers na nakausap po natin kahapon. Mabuhay po kayo at patuloy po sa pagsulong. Maraming salamat po. Just like we talk about, we exited to the ads. We will be speaking live via phone patch with Ana Mala. She is an organizer for the Caregivers Action Center, and the Caregivers Action Center, or CAC, is a grassroots organization based in Toronto, Ontario, made up of current and former caregivers, newcomers, and their supporters. And since 2007, they have been advocating and lobbying for fair employment, immigration status, and access to settlement services for caregivers through self-organizing, research, and education. Hey, hello, Ana.
Hi there.
Hi. First of all, thank you so much for gracing us here at Radyo Migrante.
Oh, thanks so much for inviting me.
Oh, you're very welcome. Okay, so we can start the discussion. So maybe briefly explain to us, what is the five-year pilot project on the caregiver program and how it came into implementation?
Sure, yeah. So the Conservative government introduced this pilot program in November 2014 as a replacement of the live-in caregiver program. And this happened with pretty much no consultation with the community. So it was kind of in line with the rest of their immigration policies, as well as actually the Liberals, where they increase temporary programs, they decrease access to PR, especially for low-income and working-class people. And this pilot meant that there were no more new applicants under the new living caregiver, under the living caregiver program. So basically, a kind of beginning of closing off the living caregiver program, but no plan for how to deal with the massive backlogs. And then under these new pathways, caregivers really, like, they call them pathways, but actually they no longer have their own pathway to PR under or even their own program. So they were actually wrapped into the temporary foreign worker program. There was no more direct pathway. And, you know, we all know through the LCP, it was a very flawed and difficult pathway. And this isn't what we want, ultimately. Mm-hmm. But once they were wrapped into the temporary foreign worker program, caregivers could really not rely on that pathway at all. And the reason for that is because under these two split pathways, they increased the education requirements, the language requirements for permanent residency. But what happened was that a lot of people were coming into Canada as caregivers, not knowing that they wouldn't qualify for permanent residency. So, and it's very, very difficult to get those kind of education requirements once you're here. It would require getting a special study permit. It's very difficult, if not impossible, to get that permit while working. It's exorbitantly expensive to be able to study here. The government also separated the stream so that a caregiver could no longer work as, you know, caring for children and then caring for people with high medical needs at another time. They had to pick or choose between the two. And then the government also put caps on the number of people who could even apply for PR, who could even qualify for PR, under each of the pathways. So 2,750 under each of the pathways. The government also did a really sneaky thing where they reintroduced the second medical, which caregivers had fought long and hard to get rid of under the Juana Tejada law. And they also, the one nice thing they threw in there was that they made the live-in component optional legally. But the thing is that for most caregivers, it's actually not an option to live out from your employer's home because of the low pay and the high cost of living, but also most people hiring caregivers want live-in caregivers. So, and then another major thing in this new program, the LMIA, so the Labor Market Impact Assessment, which is what an employer is required to apply for in order to hire a migrant worker. The rejection rates have been extremely high, very long wait times, which means there's been a lot more precarious work and work without papers and obviously increased exploitation. So kind of to sum it up, we've seen like very low numbers of workers being able to obtain PR, overall increase in temporary status, and a lot of workers in a lot more vulnerable conditions under these new pathways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Hi, Ana. This is Jekers here.
Hi.
Yeah. And I have just a question. So on top of the problems of the present caregivers with their language requirements and their educational requirements, what about those caregivers who just came in, who just started late 2017 or just this year? How do you think will this affect their application for permanent residency?
So you're referring to the sort of the government update on their website, right?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, Immigration Canada put up this post on their website, very inflammatory, saying, you know, these five-year pilot programs are scheduled to expire end of November 2019, mm-hmm. Et cetera. Mm-hmm. So what happened immediately following that, many caregivers and people like myself who work alongside caregivers in the struggle, you know, got together and started putting some pressure via media work as well, to really say, this isn't okay. You can't simply, you know, because you made a gaffe in how you organized or planned a program, that should not impact caregivers this way. And we very quickly saw that a few days later, they updated what they had on their website, and it now says, we are reviewing the Caring for Children and Caring for People with High Medical Needs pilot programs. We will announce the details well before the pilots expire. So I don't, to be honest, as you know, I can't say exactly what they have planned. Mm-hmm. I can say that there's a huge amount of motivation and mobilization happening, and the community is starting to get very organized. Mm-hmm. And I think we're going to see the community having a big impact on what this next program looks like. So, you know, it's kind of a sneaky way for the government to do this and to sort of announce that, but people aren't just taking that without fighting back. And and so I think what we're seeing right now is a really kind of amazing opportunity for people from, you know, across across Canada, really, so caregivers and allies and advocates to come together and just say, we actually all want the same things, which is for caregivers to not face this kind of exploitation, to be able to work in dignity and live in dignity and have access to be able to come here with their families from the get-go with permanent residency upon arrival.
So, Anna, I could see that this, coming from an observer, I could see that the Canadian government has been changing its policies on the caregivers for a long time already. How... It makes you wonder why there isn't already a caregiver program in place that will stay in place. How? Why do you think this is so? And why do you think it's easy for the Canadian government to just experiment, quote unquote, on the caregiver program?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think the short answer would be racism and sexism. I think... And classism. Like, I think that what we see in most other economic migrant programs, or in most other, sorry, in most of the other immigration programs, the norm is for people to come with permanent residency. So what the government calls high-skilled work, which is actually just a pseudonym for people who have money, they think it's totally makes sense for them to come with permanent immigration status. And so what we have been saying, and, you know, I can't even speak, that what caregivers have been saying since the 70s is actually, you know, when these programs started in the early 1900s, when it was Europeans coming, they were coming with permanent residency status. And so, and a lot of other migrants come with permanent residency status. And we know that without that, it is very, very difficult to assert your rights at the job. And so, I think that the experimentation piece, what you're speaking to, I mean, there is the issue of change of government and different policy, but what we've been seeing as a trend over the past 15 years, let's say, in immigration policy is a move towards temporary programs for low-income people, for working-class people, while boosting up the plan, the kind of access for those with higher income sources. And so we really oppose that as racist and classist. And frankly, caregiving work is not valued in the way that it should be. And that's part of the sexism of this society. And so it's something that we are really trying to speak out against and say, you know, doesn't it matter to you who's taking care of your loved ones and that they are... that they want to be at their job because they're treated well. I just honestly, I have a hard time even wrapping my head around it. But yeah, that's sort of how I would speak to that.
Anna, let me just go back with the program itself with two streams. Do you happen to know why there were two streams? I mean, it used to be just one, one pathway,
one,
right?
Caregiver program.
Exactly, yeah. One caregiver program. It doesn't matter what level it is. Why two streams now?
I mean, I think that there are a lot of different factors that led to that, and I can't entirely speculate about all of it. But I would say a couple of things. I think that they are trying to find ways to phase out the permanent residency pathway. And I know that they're claiming that they are not, but I think that they are trying to find a way to divide people in terms of, oh, this is a sector sector of work that is then divided into other sectors, when we know that, in fact, many of these primarily women have been trained as nurses back home and are quite qualified to work with many different kinds of people. And so I can't speculate exactly why they did this division, per se, but I do think that that allowed for them to introduce these caps on permanent residency, and then also based on the, like, NOC, so the kind of, like, code that people get based on what kind of work they're doing. It also has an interplay, so these are immigration policies, but it has an interplay with ESDC, so Employment Social Development Canada. They work with employers, and so basically the government just bows to what employers want, right? And so but one of the things that we're seeing is, like, when we do talk to, you know, it's rare that we don't focus on employers, but when we do talk to good employers, they don't want people working in their homes who are in such precarity. Like, the good employers actually don't want that. And so that's another kind of another conversation altogether. But basically, the government really does bow to, you know, who's paying, who are the elite in society, and what do they want?
Mm-hmm. And I just want to comment as well, Anna, because the notice came out pretty late. Because when I saw the website, it was just very recent when they announced the changes. I think it is also right after the community is, you know, taking its voice out there, out for the government to hear, because there was no notice. No, I mean, when the Liberals came into power, I don't think there was a notice. I don't know if you guys know, but there was no notice at all, because this was the Conservatives' plan, right?
And so, exactly. And I think one of the things is, and this is part of the difficulty, is that when it's just governments and, like, government officials sitting in rooms by themselves and coming up with policies, these are the problems we see. So they came. It actually was a ministerial instruction, so an instruction from the minister to develop this program, which means it expires after 5 years.
Yeah.
But that's not obviously something that someone who's applying for a work permit to come here is going to understand or know about, nor should they have to, right? So it's actually really about the giant, massive disconnect between what's actually happening on the ground. And I think the thing is, you know, as much as I do believe governments are, you know, deeply invested in preserving the status quo, I also think that the government is severely out of touch with the reality that if Canada stops having, like, very clear access to permanent residency for caregivers, why would they come here? Like, there actually isn't, if there is really just only temporary programs, there wouldn't be the same desire to come here. They could go to other countries and make money and send money back home. And so I think that the government is so out of step with what's actually happening on the ground.
Mm-hmm. And because you're an organizer with the Caregivers Action Center, I'm sure you've talked to a lot of caregivers, especially in this program.
Mm-hmm.
How are they taking this news? I mean,
yeah. So actually, and just, you know, I was really hoping that we would be able to have someone on the program today who is in the New Pathway, and we weren't able to get that organized in time, but definitely down the line, we can certainly make that happen.
Definitely,
when I've been speaking with caregivers, like, they're very afraid. So I'm hearing, you know, what will this mean for me? This program already felt so challenging, and now this. The only good thing that people hear about the program is that the processing times are fast. And the government beats us over the head with that. Like, well, it's a very fast processing time. It's like, well, if everything else is bad about it, and it's very difficult to even get to the point where you could apply for PR. So they're afraid, and also just feeling it's unjust, and they want to do something about it. And so, you know, as you both know, we co-hosted a big community meeting yesterday. So it was Caregivers Action Center, Migrante, Gabriela Ontario, Kairos, Caregiver Connections and Education Support Organization, Neighborhood Office, and then there were other organizations present, right? So we actually had about 75 people, many of whom were caregivers, in attendance. And so we heard a lot of things from caregivers, but certainly the strongest message is that they know caregiving is a permanent need here in Canada, and that there needs to be a permanent solution.
Mm-hmm.
And they want their work to be respected and seen as the vital work that it is. And the call really from this group of over, 10 different organizations and caregivers from across the GTA, Hamilton, Orillia, Kitchener, there were people from all over there yesterday, and across the country, we're hearing from West Coast to East Coast, the call is for permanent residency upon arrival and staying united with families. So rather than, the government always talks about reuniting families, why should they have to be separated from the get-go? And so we're hearing, yes, some fear, but also some quite a bit of excitement and motivation that, wow, some caregivers not even knowing about the possibilities to organize around this. And then I feel like there's really a bigger movement building.
I'm going to ask you this as of, what is the next step of this entire movement? In terms of how is the movement going to challenge this?
For sure. So I think a lot of what we talked about yesterday and a lot of the conversations we've been having, so Caregivers Action Center, we have a core membership of around 10 caregivers who meet every month, and they make all the decisions in the organization, and I kind of help carry out those decisions. But a lot of, what people are wanting to do is, yes, these things are happening with the government. Yes, we know the government has a lot of power. And also what we want to do is continue to meet and build unity among caregivers, allies, and advocates across the country and, in our local regions. But building our base and building the power in numbers, because what people know is, the government is going to keep doing all these different things that they're doing. And so we need to, of course, deal with that. But we also need to simultaneously really work on building this base. So continuing to, support caregivers where they're at and center caregivers' voices. As we know, there are consultations happening. So immigration, so IRCC, they are not publicizing consultations. This is very much the Liberal government's way, They'll announce last minute a town hall. No one will be able to organize to get there, or just a few people. But several organizations have been invited into individual consultations. And so we're in conversation together about that, about different strategies that we can take. Because what we know is that when the government makes these decisions behind closed doors with no one there, it's a terrible result. So we are definitely invested in some way participating in those consultations. We're also continuing to open up spaces for caregivers' voices to be heard, whether that's at public education events, directly to politicians, in the media. And so we're starting mobilizing from off of the energy from yesterday, which truly was palpable, I would say, in the room. We're going to have a contingent in the International Women's Day March next Saturday. I would say look out for some media around March 8th itself on International Women's Day. And then we're also continuing the fight to end the medical inadmissibility regime with a National Day of Action on March 12th. So this is an immigration policy that affects a lot of caregivers, where even if they go through all the difficulty of meeting their requirements for permanent residency, they could very well be rejected because they or one of their family members is sick or has a disability, which we know is discrimination. And people, organization, tens of, about 25 organizations initiated and signed onto a letter opposing this medical inadmissibility regime, and there's been a review. So we're really continuing that fight to really tell Minister Ahmed Hassan that, this needs to end. They need to repeal Section 38.1c. So we're continuing all of that work and all of our regular daily work, too. So we run a hotline for caregivers that people can call and continuing to do our kind of regular events and things like this. So really just like building the momentum and helping making sure that all of us who are doing this work are in open communication with each other. And, I think the government has a lot to be afraid of, because I think there is a united movement building, and they should look out.
And unfortunately, Anna, we are about to end this segment, but I'm going to ask you a final message from you to our listeners in Raja Migrante.
Sure. Well, just thank you so much for having me on here, and I hope we can continue this conversation.
You.
And just a basic thing that, like, caregiving work is vital work, and it's work that makes it possible for the society to function. And in order for caregivers to be able to assert their basic and fundamental rights and live and work in dignity, we know that they need to be able to come to Canada with permanent residency and with their families. And we would invite you all to join the growing movement of caregivers, allies, and advocates who are calling for the government to actively consult with directly affected workers in the creation of any new immigration policy program or legislation that will affect migrant workers, and that we really just mobilize together, because migrant workers deserve to live and work in dignity.
Okay, on that note, thank you so much, Anna Mala, pardon me, from Caregivers Action Center. Thank you so much.
Thank you both so much.
You're welcome. Bye.
Okay, bye.
Ayun. Very short, but very,
substantive.
Exactly. Very substantive ang ating isa na naman pong episode. Siguro i-wrap up natin, no, based on what we discussed. Siguro, sino gustong mauna? I mean,
I would just reiterate whatever Anna said earlier. I didn't join the discussion. It was just actively listening. That care work is vital work.
Yeah.
It should be valued by the government.
Exactly. At kailangang hindi sila sektor eh. Kasi manggagawa sila. Mm-hmm. Katulad natin na mga manggagawa din, mm-hmm. they must be a part of us. No? Because workers are sectors of the society where we should mm-hmm. all be valued. And that includes the caregivers. So, ang nakikita ko dito, ang ginagawa kasi, nagiging nagkaroon ng divide and conquer eh. Mm-hmm. That shouldn't be the case. And we should learn from the mistakes in the past. No, na nagkakaroon ng divide and conquer, this time we must be united, dahil mahirap yung mga pagbabagong magaganap sa 5-year pilot program ito ng caregiver program, kasi nga mawawala na yung pagkakataong makapag-apply for permanent residency.
And also just to add on to that, yung worry for Filipinos who are pinning their hopes to move to Canada because of that opening for permanent residency is closed. Is threatened, no? So, and just to acknowledge the fact that the Philippine government is sending Filipina bodies to go abroad for work and to remit back to keep the economy afloat, no? So we have to also take into account the Philippine government's role into this trade.
Oo, kailangan managot din, no, ang gobyerno ng Republika ng Pilipinas kapag napapauwi yung mga kababayan natin, o kapag namatay, kasi ang dami ng ganung kaso eh, hindi lang dito sa Canada kundi sa iba't ibang bahagi ng mundo. Mm-hmm. So between the sending and receiving countries, yung Canada at saka yung Pilipinas, kailangan magkaroon ng responsibilidad in terms of how are they going to face the Filipino people when it comes to issues like this. And not just only Filipinos, kasi maraming caregivers na hindi Filipino.
Yeah, although 85% of caregivers in Canada are Filipinos.
Yes.
Mm. On that note, shall we do a isang bagsak?
Okay, isang bagsak. All right.
Yeah, for our community announcements, shout outs to Kwentong Bayan Collective in Hamilton. They're doing a workshop and gathering series for migrant care workers in the Greater Toronto Hamilton area, and actually at the Workers Arts and Heritage Center, Itinola for us. Thank you. And also quickly join Anak Bayan Montreal and its affiliates in Health for All PH launch, which aims to connect and provide material and financial support to community-based health program in the Philippines. The launch will be at Sol 104-3744 Rue Jean-Briand, University de Montreal on March 3rd, 6 p.m.
Okay, Kuya Jacques.
And Migrante Ontario will be holding its General Assembly on Saturday, April 7th, 2018. And for all the other details on that, please visit our Facebook page, Migrante Ontario.
Quickly rin lang, Filipino Workers Conference 2018, the theme is Uniting Filipino Workers for Good Jobs, Fairness, and Justice. The keynote speaker is Luisa Blue, one of the highest-ranking Filipino-American union leaders in the U.S. Other speakers include UFCW National Representative Alex Banag, Ontario candidate Butila Karposh, and Melissa Bayon of the Ontario Federation of Labor. For more info, contact Polina Corpus at 416-320-8703. That's on April 14th, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. at 25 Cecil Street.
And our friends from TV Migrante on Filipino TV are seeking volunteers on various roles, from maintaining social media accounts and script writing and hosting and newscasting. Training will be provided by the TV Migrante Collective. Should you need more information, you may reach Louis Quiano at 647-458-9376 or message us at Radyo Migrante FB page.
At nais nyo bang maging bahagi ng Radyo Migrante? Halina't sumali sa Radyo Migrante Collective. Kung kayo ay interesado bilang volunteer, ay maaari kayong sumali sa mga pagsasanay at iba't ibang training na ibinibigay ng programa. Ang mga bukas na posisyon ay board operator, tagapagbalita, reporter or correspondent, tagapagsaliksik or researcher at social media archivist. Sumulat lamang sa aming email sa radmig105.5fm@gmail.com o kamaya tumawag sa numero bilang 647-281-0652 para sa iba pang karagdagang impormasyon. At dyan po nagtatapos ang isa na pong napakasiksik ngunit napaka-liglig.
Umaapaw.
Napaka-puno.
Napaka-malamang episode na naman po ng Radyo Migrante dito sa Vibe 105 FM. At maraming salamat, Kuya Jeckris, Ish.
You are most welcome, Rhea.
At maraming salamat sa bumubuo ng Radyo Migrante na wala po dito at higit sa lahat po sa mga patuloy po sumusubaybay sa atin.
Sa mga nag-watch sa Facebook Live, thank you.
Yes, thank you
BC,
po.
BC, Alberta,
okay.
Prairies, Ontario, Quebec.
Alright, so ang ating huling awitin ay mula po sa Tubaw. Ito pong kapayapaan. Maraming salamat po. Magandang hapon sa ating lahat.
Mayang udto.